watching the nation's best college newscast. 11 News at Noon starts now.
Don't pass the cash. A new Provo ordinance is cracking down on, of all things, panhandlers. We'll tell you why it may not pay to be charitable.
Alternative education. Utah's foster care system aims to raise high school graduate numbers for unadopted children.
And burning up. 21 people engulfed themselves in flames on purpose. We'll tell you why this wasn't a tragedy. I'm Randall Vaudry.
And I'm Mark Chalice. Welcome to 11 News at Noon. We have breaking news coming to us from Nevada today.
Police say there are two people dead and two injured after a school shooting. Authorities say the two injured are both male and are in critical condition at the hospital. City officials have not released the names of the dead, but say the shooter is one of the dead. Police evacuated Sparks Middle School near Reno, Nevada this morning after receiving reports of shots fired. Police say the school is all clear, but students will not return to school today. A new ordinance in Provo City prevents people from passing money through their car windows while in a traffic lane. 11 News reporter Aubrey Jones spoke with Provo's mayor on this issue. Now, Aubrey, does this mean I can't give money to people in need when I'm stopped at a red light?
It does. The police say that when you're trying to give, you're actually not paying attention to the green light. The police are saying that though you're trying to be charitable, you're actually causing a lot of congestion on the roads.
Cardboard cutout men line Center Street in Provo, holding signs with a catchy phrase: safety first, don't pass the cash, park first, it's the law. Provo City Council says handing out money to panhandlers is distracting to drivers and causes cars to back up. So they passed a new ordinance making it illegal. The cardboard men are spreading the word about this new law.
We don't want to pull over some generous person and give them a big ticket when they didn't know that they were violating the law. So we're going to do this pretty thorough education really before we start strong enforcement.
The mayor says the ordinance only applies to main roads with high traffic flow. And if you park your car, you're free to give to whoever you want. The ordinance sparked a lot of controversy with residents in and around Provo, and some say it's unnecessary to make a law regarding the issue.
Safety-wise, more accidents are caused through other means like cell phone use than slowing down to hand someone money or food.
Others say the new law is keeping panhandlers away from their car, which keeps their family safe.
Not only is it not impeding traffic or someone maybe getting hurt, but it's keeping people I don't know away from my car.
The mayor emphasizes that this is not a way to discourage people from helping others, but promotes safer ways to do so.
The mayor said some good ways to still serve is to donate to the local Food and Care Coalition that gives food, shelter, and services to those that need it. In the newsroom, Aubrey Jones, 11 News.
Now, Aubrey, this law deals with Provo drivers, but how will this affect the number of panhandlers in the city?
Well, it might not. The ordinance doesn't limit panhandlers from asking for money. It just limits people from giving money out of their cars. So I guess it just depends on how much money the panhandlers still get.
Okay, great. Thanks, Aubrey.
A new federal grant will help the Utah County Emergency Food and Shelter Programs. The Homeland Security's Emergency Management Agency, through United Way of Utah County, is giving Provo Area Food and Shelter Services more than $120,000. This comes at the start of the program's busiest time of the year. Utah County's food bank director says the money is especially needed this year as cuts to the federal food stamps program begin November 1st. And one person is dead and two others are in the hospital this morning after their pickup truck and trailers flipped on I-15 just outside of Cedar City. The Utah Highway Patrol says the pickup was pulling two trailers when the driver lost control and veered off the road, killing 50-year-old Sarah Oliver. The UHP says only one passenger was wearing a seatbelt.
In the ongoing Martin McNeil trial, the court called on neighbors, a dispatch worker, and a police officer to testify. Attorneys questioned them about the day that they found Michelle McNeil dead in her bathtub. The 911 dispatcher testified about the call. Parts of the dispatch were played aloud in the courtroom.
Hey, is your wife breathing?
She is not. I am a physician. I got CPR in progress.
You're doing CPR. Do you
know?
Sir, how old is your wife?
My wife is 50 years old. She just had surgery here.
Witnesses say they helped McNeil perform CPR, but also say they didn't see Michelle's chest rising while McNeil appeared to be giving rescue breathing. The Pleasant Grove doctor is on trial for the murder of his wife in 2007. A woman is recovering today after she crashed on a four-wheeler near Saratoga Springs. Police say the woman called 911 when she rolled her ATV, but it took local search and rescue teams more than an hour to find her. Rescue crews transported the woman to a local hospital with minor bumps and bruises.
A Provo woman is facing up to 60 years in prison for starting a deadly fire. 48-year-old Yvette Kimber pleaded guilty to charges of arson, aggravated assault, and two counts of manslaughter after intentionally setting an apartment fire that killed three people back in 2011. During the sentencing, Kimber said she was sorry to friends and family of the victims. And investigators of a two-alarm fire in Salt Lake City say they now suspect the fire was man-made. Officials say the fire started in a shed behind an apartment complex where the flames quickly spread, torching the shed and damaging six apartments. All the tenants escaped unharmed. Investigators are looking for those responsible but have no suspects yet.
A report released by the Utah Foster Care Organization says that less than half of unadopted kids in Utah graduate from high school. Many alternative high schools around the state are trying to change this surprising statistic. One of these schools is Landmark High School in Spanish Fork, which is home to several of the community's foster care teens. Principal Joe Kelly says Landmark and its staff are devoted to raising graduation numbers.
Our culture, the way we treat students, is based on love and respect, based on personal relationship. The students are on a first name basis with the teachers. They receive a lot of attention and a lot of individual attention academically and behaviorally.
But some say this alternate environment doesn't benefit every child. Nicole Walker works with Utah Foster Care. She says the social setting doesn't help improve mild behavioral issues and often limits future life opportunities. Walker says many of her fellow employees and foster parents hope Utah County will widen education options for foster children in the future. BYU's chemistry program is kicking off its annual Chem Week today with some sciencey fun. Every year, the chemistry program makes ice cream using liquid nitrogen and hosts magic shows to get the community excited about science. The event reaches out to kids in hope of inspiring them to pursue a career in the sciences.
You know, science has never been my main subject, and I'm not big on it. You get ice cream and magic show, I'm totally there.
Definitely. I could go for some ice cream right now.
Still to come on Your 11 News at Noon. Glitching insurance. A website mishap means many can't access health care, and the Obama administration is not happy about it.
And catching fire. Self-incineration isn't your typical spectacle, but one group is doing it for charity. Stay with us. Thousands are unable to access the proper forms online when seeking to apply for health care. The Obama administration calls the glitches in their website unacceptable and are still working to fix the problem. Elizabeth Cohen has the story.
If you've tried buying health insurance on healthcare.gov, you've probably had trouble using the website. It's plagued with glitches, and the administration has yet to figure them all out.
I'm now putting in my county for, I think, the fifth time.
It took me 2 weeks, trying at all times of day and night, until I finally was able to log on and start filling out my application. But the glitches continue. Every time I log on, for example,
it keeps putting me back up here.
I have to fill out this same page again and again.
It's been a fiasco. Send Air Force One out to Silicon Valley, load it up with some smart people, bring them back to Washington and fix this problem. It's ridiculous, and everybody knows that.
The Department of Health and Human Services does seem to be trying. On Sunday, the agency wrote, "Our team is bringing in some of the best and brightest from both inside and outside government to scrub in with the team and help improve healthcare.gov." The administration also released one key figure showing people have filed nearly 500,000 applications for health insurance so far. But by CNN's own calculation, more than half of that total comes from the 14 states running their own websites, not healthcare.gov. In fact, just one state, New York, accounts for more than a quarter of all applications. And yes, they have their own website too.
Now, President Obama addressed the problem at the White House this morning and says there is no excuse for those problems, but despite the issues, the website still has value.
Traffic builds up in California. A group in Ohio sets themselves on fire for a good cause, and an alligator stalks a Florida Walmart. Here's your look at news from across the nation. Another worker strike has shut down the Bay Area Rapid Transit train system for the second time in just 4 months. BART transports nearly 400,000 people on an average weekday, but the strike has commuters looking for alternate transportation. BART is providing charter buses for travelers, but no trains means miles of traffic on the roads. A group determined to set a new world record lit themselves on fire in Cleveland, Ohio. A total of 21 people went up in flames to break the Guinness World Record for most people performing full body burns. That's a strangely specific record. But don't worry, all participants wore fully protective body suits. The event raised money for the food bank and for charity to help families in South Africa. And a Walmart in Florida attracted an unexpected customer. Store security blocked the entrance after this 6-foot-long alligator stopped there, causing the automatic doors to continually open and close. Authorities tried to lure the animal away when it took off into the woods. Officers searched the area but couldn't find the gator. And that's your look at news from across the nation. Randall?
Thanks, Mark. All right, Kathleen, the weather this weekend was fantastic, but unfortunately I didn't really have time to go out and enjoy it.
Well, you're in luck because that weather's going to stay here throughout the rest of this week. I'll let you know more with 11 Weather when we return. Yep, today, October 21st here, going on right now, we have some nice blue sky going on. And then there's also a lot of bikes out here today. Today's actually a pretty good day to get out and ride a bike and ride your bike over some crunchy leaves. Right now, it's about 48 degrees here in Provo with a humidity of about 50%, so that's not too bad. Perfect meet in the middle there for if you like humidity or if you don't. And it's about, wind is about blowing about 5 miles an hour, so a nice cool fall breeze. Later tonight, however, it'll drop down to about 37 degrees, and then it'll be mostly clear skies, which is pretty much normal for this time of year, and then it'll be clear skies throughout the rest of the night as well, and then the sun will go down around 6:37 tonight, so just a nice meet in the middle there for being nice and bright today. And then later on, actually, right now throughout across the state, highs in Utah, the number of the day here is 65, because it's 65 in Moab, Price, Nephi, and Cedar City. And then the rest of the cities here, we have, it's pretty much kind of around there, with the exception of St. George being about 78 degrees. And then later on tonight, temperatures will cool down into about the 30s and the 40s with about 42 in Salt Lake City and then 37 in Provo. And then going down south, it'll even cool down to about 46 degrees in St. George, which is a little bit cold. And then speaking of southern Utah, nice clear skies throughout this week going on here. Early on in the week, it'll be about in the upper 70s. And then as we go on to later in the week, towards the middle of the week, it'll warm up to about 81 degrees. And then it'll cool back down to 78 degrees on Friday. And then the evenings will be nice and it'll be in the 40s. And then same goes for northern Utah. Evenings in the mid-40s. But during the daytime, most of the temperatures will actually be pretty much in the 60s, with the middle of the week being 66 degrees on both Wednesday and Thursday. And then it'll drop down to about 64 on Friday. However, nice sunshine going on, very few clouds in the sky through both northern and southern Utah.
Sounds great. You know, everyone says their favorite part of fall is the colorful leaves. I love the snow-capped mountains. It's always been my favorite.
Yeah, well, you know, that adds even more color. It makes everything bright.
Thanks, Kathleen.
Thanks. All right, Dave, this weekend was a crazy game. It was just back and forth the entire time.
Yeah, it was. The BYU football team took their act on the road to take on the undefeated Houston Cougars, and it turned into a wild one in Texas. There was lots of scoring, lots of excitement in a game that came down to the wire. And here in Provo, the hoops team went boom. Friday night was a fun night in the Smith Fieldhouse. We'll show you what went down when we come back. After playing the first game of the season in Virginia, BYU came back to Utah and played 5 straight games in the Beehive State. But this weekend saw the Cougars get back on the road. The location, Texas. The opponent, undefeated Houston with a 5-0 record. Let's go to Reliant Stadium. Justin Sorensen with this field goal puts the Blue Cougs up 10-0 just 5 minutes into the game. Sorensen's next kick just a few seconds later. DeMarcus Ayers from the five, he would go all the way. The first kick return for touchdown against BYU since Georgia Tech did it last season puts the Red Cougs on the board early in the game. BYU's next drive, Taysom Hill finds Rossipo, a good Texas homecoming for the BYU receiver, his first touchdown in his past 15 games. Houston gets it back, and it doesn't take long for the home team to get back into the end zone. The 69-yard touchdown pass to Xavier Maxwell makes it a three-point game. Now Taysom Hill looking for Polisike, but instead it's Houston's Derek Matthews with the pick. Ladies and gentlemen, we are in for a Texas-sized shootout. Still in the first quarter, Taysom Hill finding Rossipo again, the second touchdown strike of the first quarter, all in the first quarter. Here we are now tied at 31, and John O'Korn to Daniel Spencer. He makes a shoestring catch, you see it right here. Avoids BYU tackler, stays on his feet. He takes it all the way into the end zone, the most points BYU has given up in a game since last year's homecoming game. Then the defense has got on track. The safety here puts Houston up by six in the third quarter. Earlier in the game, Cody Hoffman became BYU's all-time reception leader. None of his seven catches of the afternoon prettier than this. Puts BYU on top, 41-40. Not to be outdone. Houston's quarterback, John O'Korn, says Kyle Van Hoo avoids the sack and finds Deontay Greenberry, who tiptoes into the end zone, 46-41, Houston. Last chance for BYU. The man passes to the man. Boom goes the dynamite. BYU up by one, 47-46. That score would hold up as BYU wins by one, the victory sealed by this late interception by Alani Fula. And speaking of boom goes the dynamite, boom has been my favorite word the past few weeks as I got ready for Friday night. With seven new players on the court, the Cougar basketball team hosted a showcase to introduce this year's squad. 11 Sports reporter Kylie Patton was at the event and tells us how the team is coming together.
From shots to hops, players drew fans to the Smith Fieldhouse with their skills and gave them a reason to look forward to the upcoming season.
Live music, stunts, and some serious ballin'. BYU Hoops hosted their first ever Boom Shakalaka event, inviting fans to cheer on the players as they showcased their skills. Activities ranged from a three-point shootout and dunk contest to guitars lighting up the place with a concert by the hip-hop group Can't Stop, Won't Stop.
It's awesome. The atmosphere around here is just great, and it's perfect for basketball, really.
Players competed live on BYU TV to put their skills to the test and one-up their teammates. The inaugural event packed the seats at the Smith Fieldhouse as fans showed their excitement for the upcoming round ball season.
It was great. The fans are the best. They make the Merritt Center a tough place to play, and our players know that.
Freshman Eric Mika and Frank Bartley IV came out in full force for their collegiate debut, showing off their hops as finalists in the dunk contest. Mika whipped out a mini dirt bike with his final dunk to bring the house down on Bartley and take the title. Mika attributes his success to the cheering fans.
I know I couldn't have jumped like I did today because my legs are kind of tired without the fans. They really get you going.
Players may turn to the fans for support, but fans say the players set the attitude for the games and give a reason to keep coming back for more.
I'm pumped for the basketball season. I think they've got a lot of heart and a lot of spirit, and I can't wait.
Boom Shakalaka left fans hanging, but they'll get to see the Cougars in real action later this week. Cougar tip-off kickstarts the hoop season at the Marriott Center this Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. Guys?
Thanks, Kylie. That was a really good weekend for BYU sports. We saw the football team win a wild one. The volleyball team stayed undefeated in conference play. The soccer team 2-0, and a lot of fun on Friday night at the Fieldhouse.
Yeah, I think Mika, 6'10 Mika on that little tiny dirt bike, is going to become like a symbol for the team this year.
Yeah, definitely will. Thanks, Dave.
Still to come on 11 News at Noon, blind ambitions. One little girl is among the best cross-country runners in her class, even though she lacks one of the five senses.
A fourth-grade girl in California is running past her teammates despite her disability. Heaven Vallejos can't see the road ahead. She may be blind, but that doesn't stop her from running with her cross-country team. Evan runs alongside her special education instructor, who acts as her eyes and practice at practice and at meets.
We're going around the goal.
It was hard at the beginning when I started cross country, but it's getting easier.
Evan says she wants to take her running further and one day compete in a triathlon.
Props to her. That is incredible. I always think it's amazing people who have obstacles like that and just overcome them no matter what. It's incredible.
Definitely.
It's 11 News at noon for Monday, October 21st.
You can join us anytime on our website, 11news.byu.edu.
Thanks for watching and have a great afternoon.